this week on Quadriga, Inside IS, the Structure of Terror. Following another execution-style killing of a Western hostage, the Islamic State extremist group is threatening direct attacks on the US and Britain. Documents seized in a raid by Iraqi military give some new insight into the group's structure. They reveal a financing network and sophisticated logistics systems for weapons and supplies. IS provides its members with social benefits and health insurance. A personnel file for suicide bombers includes phone numbers for notifying family. IS actively recruits young people through social media. What is the attraction? And how can democratic nations fight the threat of IS? Your host this week, Ali Aslam.
Hello and welcome to a new edition of Quadriga. Well, documents discovered by Iraqi government officials show how the so-called Islamic State operate, how they're structured, and how they gain momentum. And that is exactly what I want to talk about on today's show. Who is the IS? How do they operate? And for that, I am joined by three experts, all who've been following the story very closely. Welcome to the Iraqi journalist Amir Musawy, who reports from Germany for Iraqia TV. He has also worked with the Iraqi Foreign Ministry and several NGOs in his capacity as political scientist and media consultant. Asiem El Difraoui is a Paris-based political scientist and documentary filmmaker. Currently, he is a senior fellow at the Institute for Media and Communication Policy in Berlin. He has published widely, among other topics, on jihadism. And last but not least, Antje Bauer, who is a freelance journalist with a focus on the Middle East and Turkey. She has reported for the German newspaper Die Taz and the German public broadcaster ARD. Amir, you have just returned from Iraq, where you have reported, among other things, for the German newspaper Süddeutsche Zeitung. Now, it wasn't long ago, I remember, that we all talked about Al-Qaeda being the biggest threat on the face of the earth. That has all changed. Now all we talk about is the so-called Islamic State within a time span of a little over a year. How could this have happened?
Well, Islamic State is the next generation of Al-Qaeda. Everyone knows this. But the differences between Al-Qaeda and ISIS, the Al-Qaeda operating outside Afghanistan or outside trying to plan an attack in the West. But Al-Qaeda following a new strategy, they would like to have a base, a secure base in the Middle East, in Iraq and Syria, and from that base, planning to have an expanding the state, as we call it, the state, through attacking the West through the military operation. Could be happen maybe in Berlin or London. What we saw inside Iraq with the documents that Iraqi officials allow us to see, the structures of the ISIS is quite similar of states. The people are very efficient. They give security for the insurance for their fighters. They give also a backup and a help for the people, for fighters who'd like to have a marriage, who would like to marriage or something like this. It's a kind of very organized organization, and they are really very efficient, especially with the fighting and with the weapon transportation and so on.
And how organized and efficient we will talk about in just a moment. But Asiem, once again, up until 2013, no one had ever heard of this group. Now, even US President Obama deems them to be the biggest threat to be reckoned with. Seriously, how could this have happened?
I think it was just our intellectual laziness that nobody ever heard about this group. Everybody knew that jihadism had gained momentum after 2008, 2009 in Iraq again. And those who watched clearly saw that Sunni dissatisfaction in Iraq was very high, that the Sunnis at some stage would jump on any group who would fight or pretend to fight on behalf of their rights. And the Islamic State, which has existed, has itself called Islamic State already in 2005, 2006, formerly Al-Qaeda in Mesopotamia, was still present. So it's really our negligence. Our focus shifts every 2 months to something new, a new phenomena, and then we leave the old even battlefields, just without any attention. And suddenly everybody is pretending to be surprised. And then there's a remark which I would like to make to my colleague. Again, you found interesting documents, you know, showing the inner workings, the inner structures, the organization of the so-called Islamic State. So it's an interesting information, but again, there is nothing new. Al-Qaeda in Afghanistan already in the at the beginning of this century had very elaborate structures in terms of holiday sheets for people who wanted to go on holidays, fighters, very clear contracts, very clear payment schemes, you know, how much each fighter should get in terms of seniority, in terms of the structure of, for instance, of the communication department, which was very clearly structured among a kind of press office, among people who were in charge of printing, others in terms of charge of inscription. So again, we believe we have these journalistic scoops. They're just interesting informations, but all this has existed previously, and we just didn't pay enough attention to it.
We didn't pay attention to it, says Asiem. Antje Bauer, now we are certainly paying attention. That much is for certain.
And too much attention.
Too much. Whether we pay too much attention on the so-called Islamic State, we will discuss in a little while. But once again, let's get back to these documents that were discovered and that do show indeed a somewhat efficient structure, efficient and organized structure that the Islamic State is executing in the areas that it is controlling within Iraq and Syria. Were you surprised how efficient and how organized they are?
Yes, I was somehow surprised. Because I think I agree with you, the Al-Qaeda showed a little bit the same, but they were far away from being efficient concerning, for example, how to lead a state. That was one of the reasons why they fell so rapidly. And I think it was surprising to see how well organized they are and how many people they have who seem to have really high skills for bureaucratic things or even for things like caring for weapons. They go around what we saw on Vice News, for example. They go around and control quality of things being sold. So that was astonishing for me. And for me, this is one of the important reasons why they are so successful. Because I think it's obvious that in Syria, we saw since all this uprising broke out, there were a lot of different groups who were competing with each other. Many of them were just thieves. They just started to rob people. They were not organized at all. And I think that's one of the reasons why people stick to ISIS, because they say, oh, it's working.
And Amir, the documents also show how this group is financing itself, which is how?
Well, we are talking about documents, what we got before the Mosul operation. This is the very important date. Before Mosul operation, ISIS collect about $6 million in a month. Just in Baghdad, north of Baghdad units, they call it wilaya or units. Just north of Baghdad, they collect about $500,000. What they collect also, another, what I want like to come back to yours, what's different between Al-Qaeda and ISIS, three things. First, Al-Qaeda getting finance from outside. There is some people financing from outside. ISIS do different. They finance them from themselves, from inside, with getting money from inside Iraq and Syria. Second, Al-Qaeda do not use efficiently the media like ISIS. ISIS working with the media, with the propaganda, may be more efficient than Al-Qaeda. The third point, what we saw, that Al-Qaeda also, that ISIS still have the capability of moving through Iraq and Syria and using social media. What's why I say, what we discovered, that they use the U.S. company platforms, social media, to communicate, to show their propaganda. And this is the point what the British officers talked about the last time about the using the media from the United States companies, technology companies. This is what should stop and should put a red line on this.
Asiem, so the capture of Mosul, the Iraqi town of Mosul, was a turning point for the so-called Islamic State. Why?
It's definitely a turning point, and Mosul is one of the most important cities in the Middle East, you know. It's above a million, 2 million inhabitant city. It's an historically very important city with a huge tradition, a
but
huge Sunni
financially.
Tradition.
Financially,
but okay, obviously there's a lot of trade, but I mean financially, I don't know the exact figures, but I mean, ISIS was making more money with the Syrian oil fields than with Mosul. But Mosul is a real town, and historically so important town, a town which is also historically much more connected to Syria, looking to Aleppo, than connected with Baghdad. Mosul was the provincial capital of an Ottoman province, which never really felt comfortable being under Baghdad's rule. And so it's a huge symbolic victory, and obviously, the so-called Islamic State has access to huge infrastructure in terms of hospitals, in terms of the whole infrastructure of a huge town with electricity, with... But this is only possible because we're capable of forging coalitions with a dissatisfied Sunni urban elite, which often was Ba'athist, with the Sunni tribes around. So their rule might break down very quickly as well, as soon as the Iraqi state, or what's left of the Iraqi state, would make a better offer. So that's why those people allied themselves with the so-called Islamic State, not for ideological reasons mainly, but out of their dissatisfaction with Shia-led rule from Baghdad. But those people might turn away very quickly from the so-called Islamic State. Syria, again, is a whole different ballgame.
And Antje Bauer, it's already been said that the IS is financing themselves mostly from within. But there are rumors, there is talk about Qatar, Saudi Arabia, perhaps even Kuwait being also financially supportive of this organization. What do you know about this?
They officially deny that they support them. And I think Saudi Arabia especially is feeling that it's dangerous. It's becoming increasingly dangerous for them, the going forward of ISIS. There are some proofs that there has been money coming from the Saudi Arabia, from Qatar, from Gulf State countries. I think we should not forget also Turkish support, which was, I think, the idea of having a sort of Sunni belt and of a big Sunni influence area. But I think they start realizing a bit late that this is something which is firing back to them.
But the Saudis always repeat the same mistakes. They're so obsessed with combating Shiite influences around the world, combating at this stage the Assad regime. So they didn't want to create ISIS, but they so indiscriminately financed and flooded it, same as the Qataris' money, that suddenly they need to find the daemon they self-created, the devil they created themselves, and now they're very worried. But I don't pity the Saudis, because they've done this in many regions around the world. I mean, they financed the Afghan Mujahideen, which led to the rise of Al-Qaeda. They financed privately often financed the first fighters in Iraq after the American invasion, which went back to Saudi Arabia, created, after all, together with Al-Qaeda, Al-Qaeda on the Arab Peninsula. So the Saudis really need to revise fundamentally their politics and not complain today that they have thousands of fighters which might flood back to their own country.
But I think there's a problem, because you have a polarization, because what the Saudis are doing is something like trying to stop the Iranians from getting more influence in the region. So I think the people who are really suffering from this polarization, which is going on and on.
The Iraqis and the Syrians, yeah, obviously.
Yeah, the same thing. And so the problem is that as long as you have a sort of a revival of Cold War in a way of Sunni-Shia influence region, the thing goes on.
But we can break down this game. I mean, it's very important. We talk about the Sunni-Shiite divide in the Arab world. It's And we are playing the game of the Saudis, of the Qataris, of the Gulfies, in a sense that, I mean, the Assad regime, I mean, frankly speaking, the Alawis are some syncretic Islamic sect which has as much to do with Shiism as maybe Buddhism has to do with Shiism,
well, or
something,
you know. Well, they're supported by Iran.
Yeah, they're supported by Iran, you know. But we also play this division game, and it's obviously that some stage to calm down the situation and to start meaningful negotiations, we need to bring in Iran, which the Saudis don't want to do at all. But it's a matter, it's just a matter of time until Iran will sit at the negotiating table. And the total horror for the Saudis is the rehabilitation of Iran as an American partner.
That's
something they really would like to prevent. And everybody knows that Iran, in some ways, is a much more natural ally to the United States than Saudi Arabia.
Absolutely. What we found in Baghdad, there are many evidence of engagement of Qataris and Gulfies in Iraq in financing IS. There is an evidence. Of course, the evidence cannot show it in the press, in the media, but there are many people, private, let us say it, private people, supporting ISIS inside Iraq for the reasons that you told. But Iraq government use every chance, every possibility, trying to explain this is a working with the fire, trying with their brothers' countries, telling them this is a very big dangerous, not for just us, coming back to you.
But the problems are real. Is the fact that all this Shia-led governments didn't find a place for the formerly governing Sunnis of Iraq and didn't make real concessions to what is now the Sunni minority of Iraq. So it's really not astonishing that those people don't trust the Iraqi government. The 2006 surge, American-led fight against what was at the time already the first Islamic State, the Iraqi state at this moment promised so many things to the Sunni urban elite in places like Mosul, Fallujah, Tikrit, to Sunni tribes. And all of these promises were broken. And that's a big problem of what's left of the Iraqi central government. Nobody among the Sunnis trusts them really anymore.
Well, if you're following the last development in the political arena in Baghdad, that the new government in Iraq give more chances and give more area for the Sunnis. We have now defense minister. He's his own.
Might be sincere, but there's a lack of trust. That's the point.
Okay. The lack of trust. Maybe it's real, but in the last time after Maliki went far away from his position as prime minister and came al-Abadi came with a new wind, politic wind inside Baghdad. Now we are talking of real participation of Sunnis inside the government in Iraq. And what we saw now from the gaining back the ground from Iraqi military, it is an evidence that the people coming back to the trust to the Baghdad government.
Antje Bauer, the so-called Islamic State is being led by Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi, a self-proclaimed caliph. He's also known under the name Caliph Ibrahim. What do we know about this guy?
Well, he's a cleric, as far as you know, but what I find interesting is that he self-proclaimed himself, and now, some days ago, a lot of clerics throughout the Islamic world said, in Islam, you cannot proclaim yourself caliph as long as not every Muslim agrees to this. So
it's a little more complicated even.
Yeah, I think it's more complicated anyway, because after the four first caliphs, nobody has been agreed on by everybody. But I think that is the interesting thing. We thought 1 week ago, when was the attack, we thought he had been killed, but he survived as far as it seems. And it's interesting to see that he tries to lead something like a state which is at the same time modern, as you say, and at the same time it goes back to the beginning of Islam in itself. It reminds me very much.
It doesn't go back to the beginning of Islam at all. That's just what they pretend. In fact, they're completely deforming Islam, and they deform it as the better, as they're claiming to be truthful to the roots of Islam, which they're not.
Yeah, I mean, but I think, if I may explain what I mean by that. In the beginning, the Prophet Muhammad, he conquered a lot of countries by this word, but also he introduced new laws. And
Muhammad itself didn't conquer any country.
He conquered tribes, if you want, not countries in the modern sense, but he did the conquests in the word of Islam, and he did it on one side by the sword, but also on the other side he put new rules, and this is something which reminds me what they are doing right now. They do it with weapons, but they do it also making new old rules somehow.
They only do it with weapons.
Al-Baghdadi bring a new definition of Khalifa, as we can say that like this, because as Abdulazim said, you cannot put yourself as a leader, although someone elect you. But these people coming with ideology, it has nothing to do with Islam.
Nothing
with Islam. This is the point that many Sunnis now disagree with the ISIS, with Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi, who is also Sunni. They said, okay, we suffering from Baghdad government some years ago, but still we don't accept your ideology. And that's why they executed them.
Well, if it had nothing to do with Islam, as you say, how come it attracts so many followers then?
Well, they use some parts of Quran, they trying to redefining this verse of Quran of their in behalf of themselves. For example, you say in Quran said you should go to jihad. For example, jihad that doesn't mean fighting, but jihad to bring yourself stand up and trying to arrive something in your life. But they misusing this in a kind of fighting and killing other people, which they are not believe in what I believe in. This is the point. Al-Baghdadi is a close friend of Az-Zarqawi in the Mesopotamian state,
the butcher of Baghdad.
In Baghdad. And he's been also in Boka, in a prison in south of Iraq. The Americans know him very well. And when he left the prison, he told his prisoner, the guards there, "We will see us in New York." This is a real message. That's what the guy is going to plan. What is the vision of his state? Let us say it like this.
I would like to make a point in terms of, we're talking about Al-Qaeda, we can talk about Boko Haram, we can talk about the so-called Islamic State. Let's more often talk and observe a phenomena which is called jihadism, which is the ideology of all these groups. So if we would have observed this ideology more closely, we would have been less surprised of what's happened in Mali, what happened in Iraq, or what's happening currently in Iraq and Syria. Why is jihadism attractive? So there are two reasons. Firstly, they in some ways hijack Islam. They really hijack it, turning it into a sect. What does a sect promise? The sect promises you a salvation miss, saying, you join us, you come with us, you're on the hijra, in the voluntary exile like the Prophet founding the first Muslim community in Medina. So it's promising, if you join us, you live like the Prophet and you're saved. The worst promise, second part of the promise, is and if you get killed in a suicide attack, you are a martyr and you are not only saved, you'll enter paradise before all other Muslims, before the day of final judgment. So there's this eschatological promise, which is very powerful, appealing to the collective unconsciousness, subconsciousness of Muslims. But secondly, where they're very smart again, they manage to adapt this ideology to regions where their rightful local complaints or discrimination about governments. Where did it work? With the Tuareg in Mali, because rightfully the Tuareg complained not been fairly treated by the central state of Mali, by the central government of Mali. Why is it so strong in Syria and Iraq? Because the Sunnis of Iraq complain for many years now to be discriminated very badly by the Shia-led government from Baghdad. And obviously Syria, where the Syrian Sunnis have been oppressed for so many years.
Saudi Arabia, what about the Gulfies?
Yeah, but
this is the same
principle. But it's not a mass phenomenon. Al-Qaeda on the Arab Peninsula, the first one, could mobilize 1,000 to 2,000 persons in the kingdom. Now we're talking about tens of thousands of people and an area really under control of this pseudo-caliphate.
Well, I'm sorry, I have to jump in, because it's true what you're saying. The so-called Islamic State is currently limited to the territory of Iraq and Syria. But there are people who are concerned and say there's some countries that are also very much in danger of getting absorbed, namely Jordan and Lebanon, for instance. Would you subscribe to that?
Yeah, sure. Syria is a border country, and it's a Bilad al-Sham. It is always something like
it's a historic region in globes.
Historical region, and they say in Lebanon, when Lebanon snoozes, Syria gets cold, and vice versa. So this is one thing, and I would even go further. I would say, for example, what's happening in Yemen has something to do with that. I would not want, but I would like to add something to what you said regarding the attractiveness of ISIS. I think what you said is true. That is politics, but I think there's something more. There's nothing more successful than success. And I think being part of ISIS right now is cool.
You're with a winning
team. It's
cool
and sexy.
You're with a winning team.
Young guys go there, they have a weapon, they are given women. This is nice life, I think, what they have, and they are still the adrenaline of tomorrow maybe I will go to die.
And go to paradise. So nice life and nice death.
Well, one thing is for certain, the success that Antje Bauer is talking about is certainly evident in the fact how the so-called Islamic State moves on. And as we've already talked about, it's so far only limited to Iraq and Syria. But there are other countries that are very much on the verge of being affected by it. If and when that happens, we'll see. Let's take a quick look at one particular country, namely one that has already been mentioned, Lebanon. How do the people in Lebanon react to the threat of the so-called Islamic State? Let's have a look.
In central Beirut, relatives of people held hostage by jihadist militants have set up a protest camp. Yaudat Yaba's son was kidnapped in August.
What did this boy do to anyone that he was taken hostage? I raised him for 30 years. He's my only child.
During an attack on the border city of Arsal in early August, Islamic fighters took several Lebanese soldiers and policemen hostage. They beheaded two of the captives. God willing, I hope they don't come here because they're very dangerous. They don't think like us. They just want to kill everybody.
If we Lebanese come together and support the army, then IS can't hurt us. Otherwise, it'll be as bad as in Iraq.
But Lebanon's politicians are split over how to tackle IS. And some observers say this is opening the door for the terrorist group. This woman's brother is one of the hostages. She still hopes the government will negotiate with the militants. We live in constant fear that there will be more killing. We hope that those who have been killed already are the last who will have to die. For now, the family's vigil continues, with no end in sight.
To know and inside the people in Lebanon, evidently and rightfully so, rather concerned about the so-called Islamic State already having an impact in their own country. How likely is that?
It is likely because the border is anyway very porous, and since many years there's a strong fundamentalist streaming inside there, also supported by a fraction of the Palestinians, for example. And Lebanon is very shaky anyway, and I think it will be difficult that Lebanon it has already lived through repercussions, and I think they will go through more of that.
Amir, the question now is, we've already established who's behind the so-called Islamic State. How do they finance themselves? How do they get to be so successful in relative terms? Now the question is, of course, what are we going to do about it? How to tackle this growing movement? The U.S. military airstrikes, by all accounts, weren't very effective, were they?
Well, and in part of my view, that should be the solution in two parts. The first part in the battlefield, in the ground, what the United States is already, with the allies already, giving backup to the Iraqi militants, whether in North Iraq, Peshmerga, or whether in Baghdad central government. It should be more and more backup in this battlefield, because it is very important in Iraq and very important for the region. This is the one side. The other side should be a political solution. Coming across the Tehran to Washington, gathering people and following a one strategical goal, which is the fundamental principle inside the region, should not gain a ground. This is in behalf of the interests of Saudis, and it's also in the behalf of the Iranians. And between Iranian and Saudi, there is many countries: Yemen, Lebanon, Iraq, Jordanian. A lot of countries could gain stability when the Saudis and Iranian, under the cover of United States, could be in the minimum agreement coming. That to be in agreement that this is a very dangerous for whole region.
Asiem, it is very dangerous for the region. I think that much has been established. Still, the question remains: how to fight this? President Obama went on national television and said, "We're going to conduct military airstrikes against the so-called Islamic State." It's still here. It is still operating. The documents show more efficient than ever.
Yeah, our Iraqi colleague mentioned some very important points. So airstrikes will weaken the so-called Islamic State. And in Iraq, we might be able to win over their Sunni allies. Syria is a whole different game. Again, with whom do you talk in Syria if you want to win somebody over? Then again, Peshmerga might fight for some Kurdish or half-Kurdish towns. But who is going to go into Syrian Sunni Muslim towns to dislodge the Islamic State? Who is going to physically fight there? We have seen in Iraq, the Americans and the Iraqi army lost a lot of people, spent months and months, for instance, just reconquering Fallujah, a small, medium-sized Iraqi town in 2006. In Syria, you have 20, 30, 40 of those towns of this size. Who is going to physically go onto the ground and dislodge what's left of the Islamic State? And to whom can you talk in Syria? The dictatorship is still in place. The moderate Sunni opposition is quite weak. The former secular opposition, in brackets, Free Syrian Army, is extremely weak. So what are you going to do in Syria? What do you have to propose in Syria? In Iraq, it's quite simple to propose some things, because the Sunnis want to have their part of the oil share, they want to have their part of government. But what can you propose in Syria after you left the Assad regime? But hold on, I have another important point in terms of the whole region to make. ISIS is claiming they struck down Sykes-Picot, in a sense, artificial colonial borders. I think we really go into a reconfiguration of the region, which many of these people of the region want. As I said earlier on, Mosul always looked more to Bilad el-Sham, meaning to historical Syria, than to Baghdad or the same. So there will be a reconfiguration. Lebanon, the most dangerous thing, is obviously the revival of religious and ethnic religious tension. I mean, this country which is run on religious grounds. Mm. The Lebanese Sunni minority, very close to Syria, in towns like Tripoli, get more and more Salafi, get also in parts GID. I mean, the Palestinians are a negligible quantity, even though they're still fighting. So we get into reconfiguration where we might have a kind of bigger Sunnistan, and let's not hope between Iraq, Syria, and Lebanon. But let's hope that the Sunnistan is not run by people like the Islamic State.
The interesting thing for this, in fact, is, I think, what will happen to Bashar al-Assad. because right now it seems that they are starting to think about if the only possible solution to defeat ISIS would be to do somehow a coalition with the Assad regime in Syria and to see how to deal it. Should it be maybe Assad regime without Assad? Until now, he sees no reason.
I will tell you something about Syria, which is, seems very important. Excuse me, it's very important. The Syrian Alawis, for example, they hate Assad more than everybody. But they're so scared that if this regime falls, they will be driven out of Syria, massacred and slaughtered. There's a Syrian slogan going around, what the Alawis say in Syria, which is, it doesn't matter about borders anymore, it just matters about the presence, that we can stay. Not, we will never reconquer Syria. The Alawis know it. They say, wogut wa leh hudut. It means, let us be present, we don't even fight to reconquer.
Amir, let's look at the facts. The so-called Islamic State has captured Raqqa, it is ruling Fallujah, Ramadi, Mosul. It stood in front of the gates of Baghdad. The fighting in Kobani, of course, is still going on. My question is this, after everything that I've heard here, it is still, and the structure is revealing that it is already governing over a population of 6 to 7 million. Do we perhaps have to get used to the idea that the Islamic State is here to stay?
I think no one in the West, also in the region, are interested to see the Islamic State as a state and recognize it as a state. No one. Because their ideology is nothing to do with the normal life of the politic nowadays. But what we see now, they are fleeing from Beji. Beji gaining back from Iraqi militants 2 days before. Ramadi, they are not governing Ramadi, they are fighting inside Ramadi. In Fallujah, the Iraqi army is closer than 20 kilometers to Fallujah. They are losing ground because the Sunni tribe understood that ISIS is still not their partners. It is not the partner that they can trust in for the future. Besides this, there is a political movement inside Baghdad gaining more tribe, Sunni tribe, engage them in the military operations against ISIS. The point is, what you said, what I'm now seeing in the public media, and the West media, that there are some preparation of the public media to rehabilitate Assad. That someone, when I see some official said, Assad is not a partner for us, this could give me as a political analyst that in the future, in the near future, could this change? I think in the end, the West should in the end tackle with this problem with Assad, gaining some backup from him to solve this problem.
Antje, the question has already been raised, and since we're drawing to a close, I want to bring it up again. Not just if the so-called Islamic State is here to stay, but are we also, including on the show and the media, is paying too much attention, are placing too much emphasis on the Islamic State? Are we making it bigger than it actually is?
No, I think it is big. It is changing geographical situation, geopolitical situation in the Middle East. I think we should look at it, but I think we should look at it in a bigger frame, like integrating more Iran as a local regional player and taking them seriously. I think that could change the political background and give us more place to negotiate whatsoever. This is, for me, the lesson to be learned.
The so-called Islamic State, is it? Is the media, the Western media, making too much of a thing of it?
It's not making too much out of it. It's making too much out of its propaganda. We fall into the propaganda gap. Every time there's a horrible video, all the press jumps on it, talks about it for hours. But we're never talking about the root causes of the problems in the Middle East. And all these problems have been present for a long time. So for specialists and people who are very careful looking, the rise of the so-called Islamic State was no surprise. And now we make the same mistake. We comment videos and so on, but we don't talk about the root causes of what's happening in the Middle East currently. And those need to be very analyzed, very carefully, and they need to be tackled.
So what would your advice be? Should we ignore these videos of the beheadings that we're going on?
Yeah, we should ignore them. I mean, we can relates them, but not, you know, covers them too much. But we need to talk about why the Sunnis are so dissatisfied there, the Kurdish problem, the Balkanization of Bilad el-Sham, I mean, historical Greater Syria and Iraq. What's the future then? How can you do a regional construction? But we are focusing on their propaganda trap.
Amir, I saw you shake your head.
I think we are making the same mistake with Al-Qaeda we did. We also, no one know about Al-Qaeda, nothing. Although they made propaganda for themselves, no one interest in the West about their propaganda, as you said, at that time. And suddenly, they came back to New York and they make 9/11. And then beginning, we began to discuss about this. This mistake, we should not do it again. I think we should following and analyzing what are they doing and what are which goal they are following to. What Baghdadi said 2006 in Boka prison in Basra for his guard, we will see us in New York. This is very well.
I totally agree. We need to follow them very carefully. What I'm saying is we shouldn't jump and give them mega coverage on each little bits of pieces of horrible propaganda, for example. Really follow them analytically.
Antje is a journalist and also interested in the region, and she's following all the news about this matter. She was surprising about the document that we show in the newspaper. This is we slept all the time, and we wake up again after we saw there is some people coming from Europe, go to the region fighting with them. Just because of this, we waked up and we began to following their news. If there is no problem in the security situation here in Europe, we should not interest in any more old men.
Well, the question remains, we haven't fully established it, how to deal with the Islamic State. Should we ignore it or not? I think that remains to be seen. One thing's for certain, the so-called Islamic State is certainly having an impact in the region, certainly in Iraq and Syria, and we will continue to follow this story and the movement as it unfolds, of course. Thank you to my guests for a very spirited and enlightening discussion. And I want to thank you out there for tuning in, and see you next time for a new edition of Quadriga.